Random House Audio presents Lay the Favorite, A Memoir of Gambling by Beth Raymer. Read for you by Phoebe Zimmermann. Chapter 1. The Crew. The thing I liked best about working at Como was Jouty, the invisible spirit who controlled the restaurant's destiny. I had never actually seen Jouty, but the kitchen staff swore he existed. They said he was a 7-foot-tall Native American chief, a ghost from the Indian burial ground beneath the strip mall. If I didn't feed him, pray to him, and bring him presents, something disastrous would befall the restaurant. As the only non-Thai, I had to believe them. So, in between seating, waiting, and bussing tables, I found time to keep Jouty happy. At the booth that was reserved for him, I'd served Jouty imported bottled beer in a frosty mug, whole fish fried in hot sauce, and coconut ice cream for dessert. I'd bring him daily horoscopes and decks of cards from neighboring casinos. After lighting his candle, I'd close my eyes and telepathically beg him to help turn my life around and get me that cocktail waitress job at the Bellagio. Jouty heard my plea, at least part of it. During a particularly slow dinner shift, one of the regulars offered to help get me a better job. Her name was Amy, and she was a massage therapist. Every Saturday evening, she came in by herself and ordered vegetable green curry, extra spicy, and took her time eating it, her oversized black sunglasses never leaving her face. One night on her way out, she slid into the front booth next to me and watched as I filled out my Stardust and Four Queens cocktail waitress applications. "These jobs are shit," she said, flipping through the papers. "I have this one client I give massages to, a professional gambler. Want me to see if I'll hire you?" I was 24 and had moved to Las Vegas to be with a guy I'd been dating for a few months. We broke up soon after I arrived. I didn't know a single person in town, but no one else seemed to either. It was 2001, and Vegas was the fastest-growing metropolitan area in America. 1,500 people were moving into the city each week. Everyone I met was very much like me and had just ended up there. After the breakup, I rented a room in a motel just north of the Strip in a neighborhood known as Naked City. In the 50s, it had been home to strippers who sunbathed in the nude to avoid tan lines. Now, bail bondsmen, hookers, Vietnam vets, and irritable motel clerks added color to the place. My motel was 3 blocks from the Little White Wedding Chapel and Johnny Toko's boxing gym and 4 blocks from the downtown casinos. Binion's Horseshoe, the El Cortez, and the Aztec, home of the 59-cent strawberry shortcake. The cigarette burns in the motel's bedspreads were big enough to fit a leg through, and the staccato of stilettos across the floor upstairs made it hard to get a good night's sleep. But at $17 a night, it was affordable, and it allowed dogs. So Otis, my 60-pound chow chow, and I moved in. The wooden nightstand showcased the room's only decor: a Rand McNally road atlas, and a magic 8-ball. Before moving to Vegas, I was living in Tallahassee, Florida, and working at a residential home for troubled teenage girls. During one Sunday morning shift, the girls kept asking me if I would let them run away. I could get their shoes out of the locked closet, open the back door, wait 15 minutes to give them a head start, and then call the cops. I could tell the psychologists that they threatened me, that one of them held a knife to my back, no, my face, then stole the keys from my pocket. "Come on," they begged. "We just want to see our boyfriends in smoke. Please." All three of them were 17-year-old white girls who got into a lot of fist fights, dealt pot, and dated gangbangers. Usually when they asked me to let them run away, I'd change the subject. But on that morning, as the girls overplucked their eyebrows and pleaded with me to set them free, I felt sad for them. The only thing they looked forward to was filling paper cups with mouthwash, shooting it back as though it were bourbon, then pretending they were drunk. They were never allowed outside, and their lunches and dinners consisted of microwavable pasta dishes high in fat. As a result, they had acne and their clothes were too tight. I didn't get their shoes from the closet, which seemed too calculated, but I did let them run away. Standing by the door, I watched them laugh and scream in disbelief, grasping for one another's hands, their bare feet skipping across the parking lot's blacktop. 15 minutes later, I called the cops. 2 days later, I was fired. A cocktail waitress job seemed like a better fit, but with no connections or casino experience, my application went straight to the bottom of the heap. After applying to the fancy casinos on the Strip, I moved to the downtown casinos near my motel. Sure, I was welcome to apply for a position at the El Cortez, but I'd have to wait for 65-year-old Rosie from Cheyenne in her surgical stockings and culinary workers local 226 pin to die before I could even get an interview. The only reason I had a job at the Thai restaurant was because my ex-boyfriend's parents, who were nice enough to offer me a job upon arrival, owned it. They weren't expecting me to break up with their son, however, and working there had become tense. I gave Amy 20% off her curry, and the following day she left a message. Interview at noon with Dink, 1459 North Rainbow. The office park sat in a patch of desert 8 miles off the Strip. Every few steps, Otis stopped to sniff and pee on the benches. Dragging him past the professionally dressed men and women enjoying their smoke break, I pulled the address out of my pocket. I hadn't imagined gamblers doing business alongside divorce lawyers and accountants. In my denim miniskirt and Converse sneakers, and with Otis scruffy and panting at my side, I felt more like a teenage runaway than an interviewee. I pulled my hair out of its ponytail so that it fell over my shoulders and hid my bra straps. In a row of offices with signs like Nevada Insurance and Coldwell Banker stood a suite with no sign and white plastic blinds covering its windows. Next to the door was a square address plaque, and scrawled in its center in whiteout correction pen was Dink Inc. From inside, a television blared. The sound of a bugle summoned horses to the starting gate at a racetrack. I knocked. The door opened, revealing a guy about 6'4", 280 pounds. His hair was a heap of shiny, springy brown curls, the kind you see in ads for home perms. Tucked into his armpit was a daily racing form, and in his hand was a puffy white bagel overstuffed with lox. He introduced himself as Dink, then took a bite of his sandwich. With mouth full, he asked if my dog had an opinion on the Yankees game. Dink was in his late 40s, but his bashful smile and distracting habit of twisting his curls around his pointer finger made him appear much younger. He dressed like the mentally retarded adults I had met while volunteering at a group home. His Chicago Cubs t-shirt was 2 sizes too small for his expansive frame. Royal blue elasticized cotton shorts were pulled high above his belly button. White tube socks were stretched to the middle of his pale, hairless shins. Inside the suite, a long banquet table was cluttered. Hockey digests, baseball encyclopedias, a baseball prospectus, sports pages from USA Today, the New York Post, the Las Vegas Review-Journal, dozens of calculators, telephones, mechanical pencils, computer monitors, and several copies of Fuzzy Creatures Quarterly, a magazine that offered tips on how to better love and care for one's hamster. At the front of the office, a tower of 6 40-inch televisions balanced on a flimsy metal stand, each tuned to a different sport. Dink took his seat at the head of the table. In front of him, stacks of cash were piled as high as his bottle of Yoo-Hoo. I stared at the money, mesmerized. He nodded to one of the TVs, and in a heavy Queens accent, he said, "We need Minnesota and under for a decent amount." Having no idea what he was talking about, I said, "Okay," and took a seat. In the long silence that followed, Dink twirled and twirled his curls, engrossed in the basketball games and horse races. The action on TV reflected off his eyeglasses, which were as thick as hockey pucks and cloudy with them prints. Rising from the floor were stacks of books, all of which appeared to be on the subjects of hockey and New York punk bands, except for one on the very bottom, "Hide Your Assets and Disappear, a step-by-step guide to vanishing without a trace." On the TV, a player from Minnesota made 2 free throws. Unsure of whether or not this was a good thing for Dink, I stayed quiet and massaged Otis's back with the bottom of my sneaker. Dink clicked the eraser of his mechanical pencil, then scribbled something down in his raggedy 5-subject notebook. He asked me how well I knew Amy. "Very well," I lied. I smiled. He took a swig of his Yoo-Hoo and asked me what I knew about gambling. The day the Fort Lauderdale airport started offering casino junkets that flew nonstop to the Bahamas was the day my family started taking vacations.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.